I'm going to introduce you straight away to the one and only, the Moody Blues.
Moody's got together in 1964.
Well, we were blues-based, hence the blues in the name. We were very much a blues-based band, doing a lot of 12 bars. Ray was originally a mouth organ player, a harp player, not a flute player. And of course, at that time, we were getting everything from America. And we were just exposed over about 3 years to the most magnificent array of music, repackaged it and sold it back to you.
Everyone was, you know, smiling and in the same suits and, you know, very regimented, and make a record that lasted 2 minutes, 34 seconds with three catchphrases in the middle eight. And that seemed to be the way it was going.
And then suddenly we started feeling a little strange because none of us had even seen a bale of cotton, let alone talk about picking one, you know, going to jump down, turn around, pick a bale of cotton. And we weren't quite sure what smokestack lightning was. And I just started feeling a bit phony singing about it, but I'm glad we did it.
So how on earth could I be truthful about what I was singing about? I had no idea. But I did know about what I knew about myself. That's when I started writing songs, when I realised the best experiences are of who you are. And all the great songs in America, really, were written about the person, their experiences, their life at that particular time. And I think that's what I think that's why the Moody Blues music today is so relevant.
The whole thing really changed when we found an instrument called the mellotron. It's a sort of strange, ethereal sound that had never been really heard before. People weren't used to hearing kind of orchestral sounds coming out of a big stack of amplifiers like that. Something calls to me. And when you mix the sound of a string section and a brass section, organ and kind of trumpety sound together, then it gives this sort of mysterious kind of sound, and the way Mike was able to layer it.
I was able to wrap these other counter melodies around Justin's vocal and his melodies. But what I was really doing, see, I was the orchestra behind the drums, bass, guitar. So what I was doing was, the landscape of it is that I was the, you know, the clouds and the blue sky and the sunshine and the rain.
It was the mellotron that really gave us that identity, and along with the vocal style that we had and the different characters, elements of the people in it.
Especially, I always tried to do things that would lift the music up and make people feel the ethereal effect. So that it wasn't just a lyric and a beat, but that there were things there that would touch their hearts and minds and their brain that would, really bring them in, suck them into it.
It really came together in things like Tuesday Afternoon and the recordings on the first album, of course, in particular, which kind of defined the Moody Blues sound. I mean, there's one instance, really, of the way these things change a song, because when I wrote Nights in White Satin, I came home from a gig one night and just sat on the side of the bed in Bed's sitting room and wrote the basic song. And I took it into the rehearsal room the next day and I played a few bars of it. Nights in White Satin. And the other guy said, yeah, it's all right, you know, just like. And Mike said, play it again. And I went, nice and white satin. And he went on the mellotron, and that's what made it the spark that brought it alive.
And then it would cut to the brass. And I love you.
Maybe I can. No, we can't get Brett's, can we? It has. It's a tape recorder that outgrew its tape recorder. So it basically boils down to that. Each key represents a tape recorder.
But instead of it having two reels and it just goes to the end and it stops, it's actually looped. Two loops going down that have rollers on them and springs. So as I press the note, the string plays, the tape plays and goes into the bin, and the springs with the rollers on them move up, and then as soon as I let go of it, they drop down again to the beginning of the tape. All of a sudden, I've got my own orchestra, and they do everything I tell them to do.
What we were looking for is we had no limits. We were, you know, we couldn't be attacked. Yeah, everything we wanted to do, we just did. And if we wanted to change key through a song, change tempo, change anything, put notes together that really shouldn't work, so they oscillate against each other, why not? You know, and that's what we to do. How can we change people when they're sitting there listening to a song that they don't drift off into, you know, into sleep? You know, you got to do something to change them. If you do a slow song, what can you do that's different that will actually bring them out of their conscience or put them back in their conscience or into their subconscious?
We were going through a lot of sort of religious and even psychedelic experiences together. We spent some time with Tim Leary. I think we were seeking and searching, that's probably the way to put it, for some kind of enlightenment in our lives. And that was a worthy occupation for a young man, really.
So raise your glass, we'll drink a toast. The little man, he'll sell you thrills.
Everyone was moving into that sort of psychedelic area as well, so everyone was interested in mind expanding, as we thought we were doing then. We were just getting wrecked, but it felt like our minds were expanding.
Something changed in the air. Something changed after that in the way that people saw music.
The elasticity, if you like, that's where it was going to come from. And I thought we were. I thought, yes, we could actually change what's happening in the world. And I think we did.
Now you know that you are real. Friends that you and me.
I didn't know that you, Murray Lerner, had recorded the whole thing. I didn't know that until you called me and said, you know, we're thinking of putting it together. And so I had no idea of the set list that we'd done or anything like that or what existed. And I was very pleased that it was recorded, because there's no real other recordings of us. And I suppose at our peak right then.
Have you heard? Have you heard?
What amazes me now, looking back, is how we managed to put over the Moody Blues music to that enormous crowd with the type of PAs and amplification we had at the time? I don't know. But it worked. You know, it worked.